countries, from Sweden, my own country, from South Africa, and some really global or EU, all EU countries. I want to talk about why women are underrepresented on higher education and higher positions in higher education. How can we explain that? Which explanations work and which doesn't? And in the end, why is this not going to change automatically? I'm going to try to prove you that it's not going to change automatically here either. It hasn't in any other countries, and it's not going to happen in South Africa. We need to do things to make a change. Okay, so those are the questions more or less that we're going to probe. The statistic I will show you comes from two of the research projects that I work with now. One of them is a Nordic project, a large project, where we look at gender equality in higher education in all the Nordic countries. So I have a lot of statistics from that, which is good. And the other project I work with is comparing doctoral education in Sweden, Australia, and South Africa. So that's the reason I happen to have a lot of statistics from South Africa, because I work with doctoral education. And that's a project together with Silander. So let's see. When I did the conversion from Mac to PC, a few of the slides went away, so I have added those as PDF files. We'll see how that goes. Okay, so why spend time here? Why are we going to spend an hour and a half on talking on gender equality in higher education? Isn't that a marginal issue? I would say no. I would say that gender equality in higher education is an issue of justice, first and foremost, because women should have the same right as men in all areas of life, and not the least in education. I will put this goal first, and only as fourth, I will put the goal that gender equality in higher education also contributes to prosperity and growth. Both are, of course, important, but I would argue that the justice argument is one. Gender equality and equality treatment are regulated by law in all countries. In Sweden, in the European Union, and I believe also in South Africa. There's strong regulation in law. But what the law says and what happens on the floor and in the classrooms is a different thing, right? And we know that. That's the case in all over the world. Another reason that we should spend time on this is that women are underrepresented men in higher education on higher positions. And that is the case, as I will show you. This is basically the same figures if we look at Nordic countries, if we look at European countries, and if we look at South Africa. Pretty much the same figures, where women are underrepresented as professors. And that says something, I guess. And fourth, as I said, gender equality correlates to economic growth. So when gender equality in education are higher, economic growth is higher. That correlation has been established in a multitude of studies. And is one of the reasons that gender equality now, these days, are put forward so strongly by your government, by OECD, by the World Bank, and by the European Union, and by my government. And then, I have my own hang-ups, why I think this is even more interesting, or so to say. The first one is that I have noticed, teaching on this and doing research in this area for like 15 years now, I've noticed that this area is full of common sense knowledge. People think they know the reasons. People think, and then when I say people, let's say, you know, old people, professors, still think that they know the reason why it's like this. They know the reason why women are underrepresented. And they don't, often. So I think it's important that we present hard facts in this area, and that we take away all the myths that exist. The sixth reason is that there is an unhealthy strive for simplification in this area. Mostly when you talk about gender equality in higher education, you will hear the metaphor of the pipeline, meaning that if we put more women into the system, we will get more women out of the system. The same argument often goes for race as well. And it doesn't work like that, because inequalities are reproducing themselves. So, we need to consider this as a much more complex issue than thinking that there is one point of the system where the women lead. It's more complicated. Okay, I would just have a few words on gender. I assume that you know a lot of things. This is my favorite author, Adichie. She's from Nigeria. And I love this quote because she put it very good. The problem with gender is that it prescribes how we should be rather than recognizing who we are. And I think she gets it perfectly. So, as I think most of you know, gender is the social dimension of sex. Gender is all the stuff we add on in our social life. And we attribute them to a certain sex, even though it doesn't have anything to do with the sex. Just because I'm a woman means that I can have a baby. It does not mean that I'm a better mother, person raising the baby, just because I'm a woman. So if sex refers to the natural differences between men and women, they are there, of course, we vary biologically, but most of the difference that we see in society doesn't have anything to do with sex. It has to do with all the things that we attribute to women or men. So, you should walk in a certain way, you should dress in a certain way, you should talk in a certain way, you should behave in a certain way. That really doesn't have anything to do with my sex. That's gender, right? So, I think in order to understand diversity, I think we need to be clear on the fact that most of the things that goes on in the classroom and in society and in research and in education actually is gendered, because we attribute and expect different things from men and women. And there's really no point in that in the end. And gender is the most fundamental division we have in human life. We divide everything between men and women, right?
Wait for a while before these slides show up.
What's going on, Emma? Okay. So, Adichie, as I showed before, her definition of feminism is a person who believes in social, political, economic equality between the sexes. That's a pretty wide definition and a pretty open one. It's very nice, but it's often another element also added to it. Normally, the definition of feminism is first a person who look at the world and recognize that there are differences between men and women, and that women in general are subordinated men. So, lower pay. Trafficking, sexual violence, we can go on forever. There, in most countries globally, we will see that women are subordinated men. That's the first part of the definition. The second part is that you think that this situation should change. So there's an action part. So mostly, it wouldn't be enough to say that, okay, this is what the world looks like. You should also say, I really want to change that in order to call yourself. I know very few people, if anyone, that would not subscribe to this. That wouldn't subscribe to the fact that this is what the world looks like, and the fact that we should change it. I don't think I've met that person yet. So, we should also remember, there is not one feminism. There's many different ideologies. So just think, and that's maybe part of the problem why feminism has such a bad reputation among some people. That's because there is some kind of feminist they don't like. But the problem is there's so many different ideas. It's like thinking there is one liberal ideology. It's not.
It's several.
Okay. Back to gender equality. So, as I said, there are two main basic arguments for gender equality. The first one relates to democracy and justice, and the second one relates more to what gender equality can accomplish. So the first one is called the justice argument, and the second one is often called the equality argument. So the justice argument is easy, it's because that's what we say in the United Nations description. Men and women are entitled to the same rights. Women constitute half of the population of the world, and they should have the same rights as men. And the fact that women constitute half the population of the world also implies that women could never be treated as a minority. And that is going on in some countries. But you kind of lump women together with other minorities. And I think that's a really shitty strategy, because women always will always be half of the population. The other argument, the equality argument, or the instrumentalist argument, is that we need gender equality because we will then have a larger pool to recruit personnel at workplaces, to recruit talented students to universities, to recruit researchers to science, because if we only recruit from the pool of men, it's likely that we will miss out a lot of talented women. And this is the idea behind the whole managing diversity ideas in US business life. That is mainly a quality argument. In order to be a better company and to compete on the world market, you have to have the best. And there's no way you will only have the best if you only recruit among the men. Especially not as the most countries' school systems show that women perform better than men. I would also argue then that part of this equality argument is the reason when we say that we need more gender equality in order to get more growth and prosperity. How the fact that we think that gender equality, or the fact that we know that gender equality correlates to economic growth, is to take the equality argument, not the justice argument. Okay. Some patterns of imbalances from different kind of countries. So, just a few points made here. First, this is the share of students, female students enrolled in South African higher education, 1993 to, oh, it's not 2915, sorry, 2015. From 43% in 1993 to 58% in 2015. That figure, 58%, is very similar to, it's the same as the European Union, as you will see, it's the same as Sweden. It's a very common figure. Most systems end up around 60% women. Why then? Why is there a majority of women in higher education? I think the easiest explanation is that in most countries, the traditional female jobs on higher levels need a university education. You can earn a lot of money without a university education if you go into a traditional male job, but if you want to be a teacher, if you want to be a nurse, if you want to be a pharmacist, traditional jobs for women, you will need university education. And this statistic holds for most of the Western world, holds for South Africa, it holds for the Nordic countries, and it holds for EU 28. Here is the one that disappeared. So now I have to. This is going to. Okay. Share of women in South Africa. So here you see that undergraduates, it says 57 here because I think it's 2012. Yeah, that's right. So 57% undergraduate students are women, 45% are the PhD students. Junior lecturer, 52%. Lecturer, 65%. Senior lecturer is 43%. Now we're getting below what we call the gender criteria, which is between 40 and 60%. That's the gender span in most definitions. Associate professors, 35%, and professors, 24%. So women are underrepresented on the higher positions in higher education. And they are even more underrepresented, if you think about it, as the undergraduate figure is more than 50%.
Can I ask a question? Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, you told me no questions during the
lecture.
Interesting to me.
Isn't that, if you look at the the higher the statistics on top and the statistics at the bottom, don't you think that situation is actually rectifying itself?
Going to get to that. That's one of the traditional myths.
I feel that's not true.
No, it's not true. I'm going
that's
to tell you why.
That I want to
do. I'm very used to that question. Don't worry. Okay. This is the first slide I found on South Africa, looking at the staff position. And that actually, this is really bad, isn't it? Yeah, it's really bad. But it doesn't really matter, because I looked at that one. What this slide did, what it says is that there has been an increase when it comes to women on positions in higher education. The problem with this figure is that it accumulates different positions. And there's no point doing that really, because we have to know. There is a big, if we know that more women are junior lecturers, then it's no point putting them together with the senior lecturer or the professors. That won't tell us anything. So what this picture will tell us is that, yes, there has been an increase of women in higher education. The gender increase has been better than in terms of race, which is bad, which we should remember. But the reason I did the other slide that I showed you first is because I think we have to divide between the different categories. Because it's the 24% of professors, it's that low number that it's a problem, really. Okay, another one that didn't want to show up. Okay, I'm just going to show you the PhDs, because that's also interesting for future academic career, the number of PhDs. So this is the PhDs in South Africa from 1996 to 2012. As you can see, there has been a very big increase in number of PhD students. The most important part, this increase has been black men, really good development, not very good for black women, not as good. So there is a difference also, and that will also have effects on future development in higher education. Okay. So, EU28 then? The only reason I put this in is to show it's basically the same figure. It's very similar to the one we looked at for South Africa. So it's 24% full professors in EU28. 37% grade B, which are senior lecturers. I think it was 35 in South Africa. And postdoc, junior lecturers, 45, PhD, 47. So you see, it's basically the same figures. There are no big differences here. This quote I took from your Minister of Education in 2016 in the plan for educational future or whatever, it's in the end with references on. It says, the substantial growth in both enrollments and graduation of women in all postgraduate categories, but especially at the lower postgraduate level, indicates a pipeline that you could lead to achieving gender parity within academia. That's what you said, Herman, right? Right. And that's what your government thinks. And I'm going to prove you wrong. Sorry, that would be nice, but not going to happen. So, I'm going to present the argument against automatic change. In order to do that, I kind of have to explain what we know so far about women's underrepresentation in academia. So, this is the Swedish figures, same as would see, similar to the South African one, similar to the EU one. We have 24% professors on top. We have, sorry, this is in Swedish, sorry about that. Well, it's professor on the top and his students in the bottom. So it's enrolled students, 60%, graduated students, 64% women, doctoral education, around 50%, lecturers, 46%. So what do we see here? You see two steps. The first one is the step from undergraduate education to PhD, which is a necessary step if you're going to have an academic career. And the second one is from lecturer to professor. So those are the two thresholds in the statistics. However, this doesn't really say us anything. We have to look deeper in order to really explain anything. This is just showing the Nordic countries, but it's very slow growth. The thing is that most of the assumptions up to 10 years ago maybe, was that if we put in the students, or if we put in the PhD students, they will come out as professors in the end. Another assumption was sometimes called the black hole of academia, that was like that the problem is that after the PhD studies, the women leave academia, often with the idea that they had a really bad time during that period and they don't want to be there. So those are the two most common metaphors that up till 10 years ago maybe was used to explain and describe the fact that there were few women on top. So the pipeline leaks not in one place. As I said before, there's a problem that there's often a strive to make this complex easy. The pipeline is leaking in many points, in many ways. But the first one is from undergraduate education to doctoral education. I explain what this shows. If you look at women, it says a one in all of the categories, biology, physics, humanities, agriculture, social science. The one means the standard point, the standard odds, and the men one means the higher odds there are for men to go into doctoral education. So the odds in biology, 153, physics, 167, humanities, 187, that's double the chance if you're a man to go into PhD. Agriculture, the only one that is diverting, but the thing is, it's a very small area in the statistics. Social science, 134, technology, ooh, almost one, almost the same chances if you're a woman and a man, if you're in technology, which is a bit strange, I don't know why, but it's interesting. Health, 127. So that means, all over, more men than women move over to doctoral education, related to the number. So that's a problem. Something missing there. The other one then, the black hole. Do women leave academia after they have finished their PhD? No, they don't. I spent my dissertation on proving that. It showed that more men than women leave academia. After that, at least four or five or even six large studies have been made on this topic. So what actually happens is that women take to stay in academia, and this is an EU context. They don't leave. So this can by no way explain the fact that there are fewer on top. In all areas, it was a large share of women in academia 3, 5, and 10 years after the PhD. And I think the reason that men leave are not because they had a hard time in academia. I think the salary gets better if they move to business. So kind of different theories apply depending on what happens. So what the conclusion then is, that what we know now, that we didn't knew 10, 15 years ago, is that the problem with the few women on top is because women make a slower career, mainly from lecture or from PhD, from when you graduate from a PhD to become full professor. And there are several big studies that actually have shown this. For example, Bessler and Sandstrom, they talk about vicious circles, meaning that men and women perform equally a few years after the dissertation, similar in terms of publishing, similar in terms of citation. 13 years after, when they measured next time, they noticed that there is a totally different career trajectory, where 61% of the male researcher has become full or associate professor, but only 32% of the women. So this is the period it happens. Explanations then. Well, the most common one, well, you know, women want to stay home with their babies, that's why. So most of the American research, for example, has been on family-oriented explanations, looking at marital status, whether or not you're married, looking at family, number of kids, age of kids, and there is still no empirical evidence that family have an effect on career. The contradictory results of publication, women publish less than men, but it's not related to family situation, and it's not related to number of kids. Women are less cited than men, but the difference is much smaller than for publications, but it's not related to family. So we have to kind of skip the family-oriented explanations that are so common that we always want to attribute deficits among women to family-oriented ideas. Self-selection is what it says in the second one. That means that women have lesser confidence, that women don't believe in themselves, that women do not like to take risks. However, the studies that has been made on this has, for example, looked at risk-taking in terms of seeking grants, of seeking large research application, and there are very contradictory results. Some results showing that women don't take as big risks as men, other studies showing that maybe they do. So, contradictory result, but very weak indication that this should be a self-selection thing. Are women less qualified? No, it's probably the other way. So, there is research indicated that women wait longer before they apply for a job, because they think they need more merits than men. So, there are several examples of women getting a position with much higher qualification than the male counterparts. So it seems not to be the case that they are not qualified. And discrimination. This is, of course, the most controversial one, that women are discriminated against in applications. In the Nordic, I cannot answer for European Union or worldwide when it comes to discrimination. But the Nordic studies that has been made has shown no evidence of discrimination. So my point with this slide is there is not like an easy explanation. These things are probably embedded in academic culture. It's harder to get grants, it's harder to get research time, it's harder to get credit. And all these little things kind of adds up and make women have slower careers. It's not one explanation, it's not one focal point. I'm not going to go into this. As I said, women publish less than men, the gender gap in publication has shrunken radically, but still a difference. So, does it matter then, the gender balance that we spend this time talking about? Why does it matter? Well, the thing is, first, gender balance is only one of several important parts in gender equality. I mean, gender equality is about other things too. It's about norms, it's about attitudes, how we behave against one another, and so on. So, but the thing is, that gender equality could be viewed both as an effect of something. So if you see a very low figure on share of female, that is probably indicating something and could be used as an effect. However, gender balance could also be a prerequisite for having gender equality. Kantor in 1977 showed that there had to be a certain number of women before workplace culture was changed. She looked at three big companies in America. And not until the figure became of a certain size, changes could take place. If that is true, it does matter how many there are. Another researcher, Phillips, had talked about how the sheer number could also affect what kind of issues come up. For example, there are several studies showing that there is a correlation between gender equality and how gender studies are treated in the university. So, if the university has a positive view on gender studies, then that's also likely that that university would perform better in terms of indicators on gender equality. So in that way, it could matter. The very presence of women could make a difference. Okay. As I said, there are pretty strong evidence that gender equality correlates to economic growth. There's a strong evidence that gender equality in employment correlates with economic growth. And there is strong evidence that gender equality in education correlates with economic growth. Of course, education and employment will always be very close to each other and related. And this is effect we see in globally. Studies have been done in many countries. The mechanism for this correlation can be different things, and here the local context matter. But example, the first one is, of course, as I said, the pool of talent. If you draw from a larger pool of talent, including the 50% women, it's more likely that you will get the best people. So that is always, this is the typical economic theory idea, the pool of talent. We also know from research, from huge, many studies that have shown that education will promote, reduce fertility levels, it will reduce child mortality, and it will also promote education for the next generation. Meaning, educated women are very likely to put their kids into education. So it will have a secondary effect, which is super important. And that will also mean a long-term effect. And that mechanism is important. The third one is not so nice. It's more related to Asian countries that has used cheap labor, women, in order to compete in the global market. However, having started to do that, they have realized that in order to grow and be more competitive, these women need education. So they kind of, which has had positive effect. So which from the beginning really was the way of using women, I would say, actually had the effect that we have to educate people that would have positive. More tricky, but still a mechanism. We can also talk about gender equality, as I said, as an intrinsic value, that education leads to gender equality and that is worth something for their own. Here, the mechanism that we can talk about are, for the first one, empowerment. That education and also employment will serve to empower women. And that's also something that's shown in many studies. Well, empowerment, this is definition of empowerment. Definition of, it's the empowerment is the ability to make choices. And that should not only be the fact that you have the ability to make the choice, you should also perceive this as a possibility to really make that choice. A lot of things we think that women or men can make choices, but if you don't perceive this opportunity, it's not really the possibility to make the choice. That's what the empowerment literature often. So empowerment is one of the mechanisms. Education is crucial for empowerment. We know from studies in many, many different countries that access to education will lead to cognitive changes in our brain that will make us take new decisions, another decisions. For example, we know that in many countries, studies have shown that educated women suffer less from domestic violence. They don't accept it to the same extent as less educated women. We also know that there can be problems with education and limits in educational terms. Talking about, for example, In many countries, teachers would hold stereotyped opinions about women as shy, not risk-taking. Meanwhile, they think that men would be more assertive, active, ambitious. And if teachers hold that perceptions, they are likely to reproduce this pattern for the future. Okay. Now I'll move on to my last part, and that is like tentative conclusion. Remember that. This is a study I'm working on now, and I will go to reanalyze the material, but I think what I see in the document is pretty clear. So what I would say is that I have looked at the Agenda 2020, which is an EU document for the future and to kind of save Europe out of the economic crisis and increase the economic growth. So I have gone through all the documents related to, in some way, employment, education, and so on. And I think there is very clear that the intrinsic values, gender as a value by itself, is very much played out compared to economic health. Gender as an instrument for economic change and for economic growth. Whew, these are the documents, all right. Terribly boring. Half of them South Africa, half of them European Union, half of them Sweden. So what you can see is, for example, when in terms of employment, policies to promote gender equality will be needed to increase labor force participation, those adding to growth and social cohesion. So, when talking about employment in these documents, there's very little about empowerment and much more about using women as a tool of recruitment. Because one of the main targets set for Agenda 2020 is to reach 75% employment in Europe. And to do that, they realized that they had to draw from that pool of women and to make them work. So that is the basic idea. When it comes to combat poverty, they talk about social inclusion policies need to dovetail with effective anti-discrimination policies. As for many groups and individuals, roots of poverty and hardship very often lie on restrictions of opportunities and rights that are available on other groups. So also when they talk about poverty, they're mostly talking about employment. So I'm not saying anything wrong with that. I'm just showing that they're not talking so much about dignity, about the right, you know, but about growth. And education, this is the most interesting. Early childhood education is one of the main ways to solve the problems. Member states should remove disincentives to female labor force participation, taking into account the demand for childcare facilities and in line with national patterns of permission to provide childcare. So, of course, in order to get lots of women out of the labor market, you have to provide childcare. So that has since 2010, this has become an important focus of the EU. So my conclusion is that here, education is a tool for economic growth. The thing is, I'm not saying this is a bad thing. I think the problem is that it risks to forget other parts, for example, sexual violence against women, because that will not affect employment and growth. So there is a risk that you only focus on women as workers and forget other important parts. But apart from that, I think it's good that they go for childcare. And I think it's good that they want women to be empowered and go into employment. So these economic arguments could, in the end, have really good effects on gender equality. That's why it's missing this area. Because you don't like the fact that they kind of forget about equality as a genuine value, but in the end, maybe making these changes will have a positive effect. So it's complex. So, when you look at the South African documents, first you see there is a strong emphasis on more, which is good, I think, which is nice. But you also see in the documents that the idea of equality and gender equality as a way to economic growth is definitely increasing. So this idea is becoming more and more important. Although there are fewer examples. So these are the examples I found. Higher education in South Africa have been regarded as key to social and economic development. Yeah, we know that. The ministry believes that more urgent attention should be given to increasing and retaining the pool of qualified black and women staff, as well as changing the disabled profile. So also here, there's growing interest in using this pool of recruitment to get the talented people. In order to get the talented people, you have to recruit about all people, not like a small part of the population. If we're to eliminate poverty and reduce inequality, we need to encourage seriously with the impact of gender on people's life chances and opportunities. Yeah. So, there are strong ideas about this also in South African politics. Conclusion. So what I tried to state here, show, is that first, women are underrepresented. Interestingly enough, they are as underrepresented in higher education in the Nordic countries that index highest on the gender equality index. They have a strong welfare society, there is low childcare, but still very few women on the top, which indicates that this is a problem that we find inside academia, not in the outer society only. So that's a bit sad, but it's also interesting. International research clearly shows that it's not going to be an automatic change, as Helen suggested. That is not going to happen. So there have to be actions to do things. For example, positive action, as already has taken place. But it's not going to go by itself, because inequality will continue to reproduce. Underrepresentation in higher education is explained by structural barriers within academia, and it happens mostly after you have your PhD on your way to become a professor. That's where it takes place. And it's not exit, it's not that they leave, and it's not family-oriented, not in the European context at least. So, old myths on gender equality has to be revealed by having good statistics and longitudinal statistics, because that's the only way to follow individuals over a longer time to see what they do. That's the only way we can do research on this. We need big material for longer periods. The reason, you know, it's only 10 years ago that this research started to come out in the Nordic countries and in Europe, is because we're very little longitudinal research done into this area. We need big statistical data sets in order to say something from men and women and men behaving in the system. And as I said, gender equality seem to be more of an intrinsic value in South African education and policy than in Nordic policy and European policy. Okay, so what is that? 15:26, that's, I have 4 minutes ahead. Yes. Now time for questions. I'm happy to go back to the slides if you want to. Go ahead. I noticed when Daniel had his lecture, was it Thursday? There was mostly men raising their hands. So I'm waiting for the women now. No, no guys dare to raise their hands. That's not what I meant. I won't take any questions.
That's one of the things they talk about.
high sensor than a low sensor. And that could be, for example, that you could see that you use such an accent. So my point is that the problem with steering points, race or gender, is that we are often not aware of them. And we keep on reproducing them because we're not aware of them. So awareness is, of course, the first thing. We need to be aware of them. And that's why I like acts like gender time, because then you can show it. It could be used for race too, you know? Cool, it's used. And you can use it at a meeting, for example. Who gets to speak? Sometimes it's two men in the room and four women, but still it's the guys who talk all the time. Yeah. Okay then, no more questions. Thank you so much for your time. Great to be here and to talk to you.
Gracias.